H-O-R-O-W-I-T-Z.
One more time.
My name is Molly Horowitz. M-O-L-L-Y H-O-R-O-W-I-T-Z. Today's date is March 26, 1998. I am conducting an interview with Henry Mangurten in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, USA. Please tell me your name and spell it.
My name is Henry Mangurten, H-E-N-R-Y, M-A-N-G-U-R-T-E-N.
And what was your name at birth?
Henach.
And your last name?
Mangurten.
The same?
Same.
Okay. Were there any other names you had during your life?
No.
Any nickname?
No.
What is your date of birth?
November 5th, 1928.
And you are how old?
69.
Where were you born?
Lodz, Poland.
How do you spell Lodz?
L-O-D-Z with a comma on top or something.
When you were a small child, on what street did you live?
Pojeczna, 14, apartment 51.
And what do you remember about the street?
It was a very lively street, a lot of stores and commerce and so forth. And
were there any other kind of buildings in that street?
Yeah, buildings all along. From 5 to 25 were the numbers in that street.
Describe your home.
My home, we lived in it was a three-building courtyard complex-like, and we lived in the middle building on a third floor in a apartment. It was a big one-room apartment, number 51, and a big hallway.
How many floors did these apartments have?
Three floors.
Were they connected in any way?
To the other buildings? No, they were separate. They were separate buildings.
Who lived with you in your apartment?
My mother and father.
And what language did you speak at home?
Mostly Yiddish, but Polish was a bilingual language. That when I went to school, I learned public school. I learned Polish, speaking Polish, and then I went to Haida, spoke Yiddish.
Can you describe your mother when you were a little child? How was your mother?
My mother was, I don't know, she was very, peppy and happy and all that. And it was a good child. She was a good mother and was a good child. Childhood.
What sort of activities did she have, like on a daily basis? What do you remember her doing from day to day?
She was helping my father. My father was a tailor, and she was also helping my father do a little tailoring, sew buttons on, and little things like that. I don't know exactly what, but I know she was helping. And she was also a cook and bottle washer.
What was her name?
Her name was Sarah, and she went by Sally also. Sura was a Jewish name, and Sally was the Polish
And what did people call her?
Mostly Sally.
And what did you call her?
Mommy. Mama.
What are some of the memories that you have of her caring for you?
For me?
Yes.
In my days when I was a kid, mother used to run after the kids with a slice of bread and butter and a piece of fruit. You know, make sure we don't go hungry while we played and all that. And that was a mother's function then, you know, and to be very protective.
Do you remember what it was like or when you woke up in the morning? Describe the scene and what she did for you, and whether your dad was there, your father.
My father was there. My mother was there when I woke up. They cuddled me like the whole world was around me, you know, and they couldn't do enough for me, you know.
Do you have any remembrances of the clothing that you wore?
Yes. I had a lot of knicker pants. Knickers. My father was a tailor, and he was, every time he had something left over or something, he made me a pair of pants or a jacket or something. And I remember one Passover, he made me a new suit. We went down plane and all. And I come up full of tar.
With a new suit on.
Yeah, well, it was supposedly a new suit.
Do you remember your father's reaction?
Reaction wasn't a good one. He was really mad. He says, I worked 3-4 days to make you that suit, and look what you did in 10 minutes. I think they were fixing the roof or something, and there was pens with tars that they... And we were playing around there, and I just got splashed all over, you know.
Where did your father do his work?
Mostly at home. Before the war, mostly at home. He had two other people helping him, working for him, and they were fabricating into a place, I'd say, equivalent of like Brooks warehouse. The men's warehouse or Brook Brothers equivalent.
Did he work for someone else? Did he give his product over to some other company?
No. He did the work himself. He was the contractor. He did the work himself, except buttonholes somebody else made. And that's the only thing I can remember, because I used to take the... your stuff to that man that made the buttonholes, and that part of the work was done there.
And when he was finished making the garments, did he?
We delivered them. My father and I, we delivered them.
Where did you deliver them?
To the place of, to the store where they were sold. It was a big store, equivalent to, like I say, a man's warehouse. But it was diverse. It was man's, ladies, and, you know, combination of everything.
To whom did that store belong?
That store belonged to the people that owned the buildings. The apartments, but the store was right near my cheder, where I went to cheder.
What about your father as far as, what did he do daily? I mean, he had this tailor work that he did, and when he was finished doing his tailoring work for the day, how did you and he
interact? Well, my father
worked...
I don't remember, but I assume that worked like 10, 12 hours a day, 10 hours a day at least, and we ate, lunch was around 2 o'clock or 2:30 was lunch, and then after he finished, I remember, and a little bit later after, I don't know exactly how long, how much later, we had, I didn't have coffee or anything. I had milk or a snack, and, you know, it took a while. I don't remember, half hour or 45 minutes, but we ate and all that, and then we went for a walk. Went for a walk around the neighborhood, you know. And
did it include visits, or
visits? We did maybe once or twice a month on weekends. On weekends, because Saturday there was no work, so went for walks and visit.
What things did you do together with your father?
Me?
Yes.
We went, there was a Bes Medrash there on the street. We went to the Bes Medrash.
Do you remember what the Bes Medrash looked like?
Yeah, it was a little shul, like I'd say equivalent of B'nai Amuna, but not as big. It was a...
Well, you would have to describe.
It was a, like
approximately.
A one bigger shtiebel and one smaller one. Uh-huh. And at that place, Bes Medrash, underneath had also a mikveh. And then they had that one big tank where they were boiling water. And Friday night and Shabbos... noontime, I used to go with the tea kettle, get a kettle full of water, hot water, for about half a dozen cubes of sugar, you know, four or five, half a dozen, whatever, or maybe different things like food or whatever, but I don't remember what.
Well, what was this for? To bring home? You mean to bring home?
Well, people did not cook or light stoves on Shabbos, so we went down there to get kettle water for tea, you know, in exchange after I brought the chilled home from the bakery. We needed tea. Oh, it was...
Tell me about that chont. Was that something wonderful?
Wonderful, wonderful. And we used to take the chont Friday evening to the baker and give you a number, put a number on each pot. And Saturday at noontime, we used to pick it up. And you could smell the smell. God knows how far away you could smell. Well, like there was only me and my father and mother, and I was a little kid. I was a teenager, but I liked the chon. I liked the potato kugel, and I liked the brown potatoes. It was out of this world. Beautiful, beautiful.
Were there any other things that you did during your father's downtime? I mean, were there other things you did with him?
Well,
other than go to the Bes Medrash?
Yeah, my father used to come down and watch me play, run around, and all that. And then when we walked up the steps, I used to piggyback right on him. Walking up the steps.
What was your father's name?
Toivia. And it was three flights of steps, and after the second flight, he says, it's time to get off. And we had lots of fun.
So what is the thing that you remember most about your father? What's the impression that's left with you about your father?
Well... I was very comfortable with him. I felt safe when I saw him near me and all, like everything else. And in the wintertime, we had lots of fun. We used to make slides out of pour cold water and make slides, and my dad used to watch me. There was a half a dozen kids, and mom and dad used to watch me, and oh, you give out, you're going to fall, and you're going to hurt yourself, and this and that, and well, I didn't resent it, but I felt a little bit embarrassed, you know, because some of the kids didn't have their fathers and mothers watching, but mine did. But, I made it through.
Were there grandparents and relatives anywhere when you were a little child?
When I was a little child,
grandparents and relatives?
My grandmother from my father's side. My grandfather died a long time ago. I didn't know him.
What was his name? Do you know?
His name had to be Loser. Lizer or Loser. And then I remember my grandfather from my mother's side. They lived in a small town named Glovno. I'd say about 15 miles away from Lodge. My grandmother, my mother's mother, died when she was 12 years old, when my mother was 12 years old. But my grandfather, he had an orchard with fruits and this and that, and that's how he made a living out of this. And then in the summertime, when we went to Glovno, me and my mother, and I waited for my grandfather. He was coming home with his little sack on his shoulder, and nobody touched it until he gave me the fruit, pears, apples, and whatever he had. Because we saw him once a year or once every 2 years, you know. He was tall. And that's...
What was his name?
Yankee.
Yankel, and his last name was?
Marine. Marine. My mother had four sisters there and two brothers. And I was busy making the rounds to my aunts and uncles. And
in Glovno.
Glovno. They all had, it was a flour mill and all that. They all had the horse and wagons, and that was the commerce there, deliver fruit, flowers from the mills and this and that. And everything was on top of water, a little pond. Pond here, pond there, you know, and once a week there was a market. They used to bring the stuff to market, and I used to make the rounds and grab an apple here and grab a piece of fruit there. And oh, what a time I had.
How about relatives? Did you have relatives in the city?
In Lodge? One sister. My mother had one sister, and she had a baby.
And what was your aunt's name?
Franya, but the baby's name I don't remember no more. And my dad had a sister with a husband and three kids also, which I'll show you the picture here.
What was her name?
Gucha. And my cousin, his name was Henry too, same as mine, Liza Hainach, you know. So I imagine my grandfather's name was Liza, Loser Liza. And then he had another sister. I don't remember if she was married or single. I guess she was single.
Did she also live in Lodge?
She also lived in Lodge, because I never saw her with a husband or a man, you know. But she lived not far from her other sister. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Well, maybe she was divorced or so, but I don't know. As far as I remember, that she was single. But she was a favorite aunt of mine, too, and she liked me. I was her favorite nephew, you know. her bad nephew, and you know, boisterous or whatever, you know.
Were there visits to her house?
Oh, yeah. She came to our house. We went to their house, and we had lots of fun, me and my cousins.
What other cousins did you have that were, that you were friendly with, that you knew?
Well, in Lodge, those are the only, those were the only cousins, just real cousins. Then I had, my dad had a cousin, which they were second cousins to me, but we maybe saw them once a year or so, and so on. But it was enough to go around, you know, for weekends or once a month or once a year or twice a year, and so on. Lodge was a big city, and my dad and I used to go to a used to take me to a park equivalent of like Shenley Park with the slides and the works and all. In Jewish, they used to call it Kolle Guten. Guten is a park, and Kolle was like everything together was rolling, like a small, well, not Kennywood, because there were no rides or anything, but just like Highland Park or Shenley Park with the slides and little slides and the horses and whatever, the swings, and we used to go there once in a while. It was far away, you know, so that was a...
How did you get there if it was far away?
That was a treat. We went by streetcar and walk. Yeah, streetcar and walk.
And were there other places that you went to outside of the outside of Lodge? Besides your grandfather's place?
Yeah. Well, this was in Lodge. We went...
Yeah, I know, but when did you travel outside of Lodge ever? Unless you went to... You know, I know you told me about your grandfather.
We went to a place called Radegosh. Not Radegosh. Kochanuvik. Kochanuvik. And it was like... what camps that my aunt had a cabin there, you know, like summer camps, and we went there like every now and then in the summertime. And this was quite a few miles away, and streetcar, we took streetcars and we walked, you know. So.
Okay. Where did you play when you were a little child?
We had a courtyard. There were the three buildings, and we had big courtyards. Then they had a form of two poles and a long pole where people used to hang their clothes and everything. And we used to perform acrobatics to swing back and forth and over and under. And so that was our really good activity.
Do you remember a favorite playmate?
Playmates? Yes. It was, there were two little girls that lived on our floor. There was a couple of boys lived in the other building, and it was like maybe a dozen. And we used to play at home. We used to pick little stones, gravel stones that were looked like pearl or something. And we used to play games like marbles, you know, and see how many we can scoop up. And then we traded. In fact, I just saw in the paper not long ago, I saw the names of, we used to trade, it was no cards, they had negatives, films, little cowboys, Tom Mix, Hoot Gibson, Ken Maynard, and Buck Jones. And they were the favorites in them days. You could get like 6-7 for one for Buck Jones. You could get 4-5 for Tom Mix, you know, lesser ones. You could get 3 or 4 for Hoot Gibson. And then Harry Lloyd, he was called the walking fly, you know. Oh, we had lots of, we were busy. Our time was taking up every minute of it with trading cards, like those little picture cards and films and so forth. Oh, it was...
Did you have a favorite playmate? Close friend?
I don't know. There was a guy had a small chocolate factory there. Lieberman was his name. I remember that. And he had his father-in-law. He was in his 70s already. And he used to recruit me and a couple others. He had a buggy with two wheels on to take the stuff over. He had a couple stores, you know. But the father-in-law, the old man, used to go with us because we used to put our hands in and nibble or something. And he used to holler and get mad at us. But we were kids, you know. But we had a good time. We had a good time. Then when we come back after the little factory closed and all that, left the wagon there, we took the wagon, we piled a bunch of kids in the wagon and took them for a ride.
When you started school, how old were you?
I must have been, there was no kindergarten there or so. I started maybe at five, six years old, and it was like elementary school. And then from there, I think after 2 years or so, went to equivalent of a high school and went there.
Let's get back to the first school that you went to. Was it near your home?
It was, I'd say, about a 15-minute walk. I don't know how long it took me. Maybe it took me longer looking around and this and that, you know. But it was like a 15-minute walk.
Tell me about that walk. Just think back and see if you can remember some things that you'd looked around at when you were going to school.
On the way to that school, the first school, there was a big factory named Poznanski. It was, sweatshirts and textile, big textile factory. And we went, had to go through that, wasn't the whole factory, but the street was covered like half of the factory. And we went through back courts and yards and all that. We always had fights because the goyish kids knew that we were cutting through for short cuts. And they started calling us names and throwing stones at us and all that.
What names do you remember them calling?
Well, and Jid.
How did that make you feel?
Huh?
How did that make you feel as a little child?
We throw box stones, and we were like in a macho, who's going to win, you know. But okay. I didn't take it really as discriminatory because we were sort of used to it, and it was an everyday occurrence.
Okay, we'll continue this on the next tape. This is tape number two. you were telling me, Mr. Mangurten, about your walk to school when you were a young child.
Right.
You can continue.
It was walk to school. We took a shortcut, went through the courtyard buildings, and it cut maybe a whole block. But the Gordisha kids waited for us, and they started, throwing jibes at us, you Jews, and go to Palestine, and this and that, and they started throwing stones and this. But we took it as we were maybe four or five of us, and there were maybe four or five or so. So we threw box stones and all that, and we sort of come out even. You know, nobody got hurt. Sometimes you got hit with a stone or so, but nobody got hurt bad. And coming back was, sometimes it was better quiet, sometimes it was the same thing. But we endured this every day. And it was like part of daily living, you know.
Were there Jews and non-Jews in your class in school?
Yes. It was, Jews were a minority in the class. More non-Jews than Jews.
And what kind of a school was it?
Was it like an elementary school.
You're not talking about a Jewish school?
No. It was like Colfax. It was an elementary
public school. Okay.
Because that was compulsory.
Did you ever have any Jewish school training?
Yes, when I went to Haider.
When did that begin?
That was after school. That began about the same time I started school. And I started going to Haider like in the evening for, I don't remember how long, maybe an hour.
And where would you go for that?
It was not far from where the store where my father worked, did work for that store. The street name was Novomienska. 24. And the name of the Haider was Mendel Tashnik.
What other Jewish activities, or did you have other Jewish activities besides Haider?
At home, homework. Yeah, did the homework.
But in the community, what Jewish community activities?
There was a little organization. We belonged to Jabotinsky's army. And I remember they trained us. We were marching back and forth and this and that, that tomorrow to Israel, you know, and preparing us to be Israeli citizens and be soldiers when the time comes and so forth. And I had a lot of fun. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it very much. Jabotinsky's. And I remember there was one, I don't know if he was Israeli or not, but they used to, in Hebrew, Hach Taim Shalosh Arba, you know, and that's, I remember that very well since I was a kid.
How often did you go to those activities?
About once every week or every 2 weeks. I don't remember. Or maybe once a month. I don't remember.
Do you remember feeling like you would really like to go to Palestine?
Oh, in them days, that's all we had in mind. We were like brainwashed. You know, that's all you knew is Jabotinsky's army and go to Palestine.
Was your father a follower of that political view too?
No, he was too busy. He was too busy working, making a living. Yeah, he was too busy.
When did the situation change in your neighborhood?
Well, I remember before the war, well, things were bad, you know, economically and every aspect, it was bad. In Europe, there was no middle class. There was poor and rich.
But in your neighborhood, when do you remember that things changed for
1939,
you?
When the German army came marching in, I remember I went to the main street, was Novomiensko, and watched the German army march in.
Where were your parents?
My parents were in the apartment, you know. But there was flocks of people and kids watching. And when we saw the German army, the equipment and the guns and the big Clydesdale horses, we were in awe. We were stunned. We never saw that before, you know. Polish army, they were charging tanks with bayonets or rifles, you know. But when the German army marched in, it was awesome what we saw, you know, pieces, equipment. We never saw so many motorized vehicles like we did then.
Do you remember your own feelings at the time?
I had no feelings. I remember that at the corner, there was a field kitchen stop, you know, and German soldiers were feeding. And around that field kitchen, we stood around, and all of a sudden, everybody is, I have to do it now, were opening their lapels, and they had those swastikas behind the lapels. Everybody was Germans, you know, like Volksdeutsche. So Poland had a lot of Germans, but all of a sudden everybody was German. They opened their lapels, and here I am. And I remember the guy in the kitchen, from the kitchen, was passing out bread or a piece of candy or whatever it was, and kids stuck their hands out. And this one guy, hey, he's a Jew, don't give him, he's a Jew, you know, like that. And I remember I was up front almost, and the guy looks at me, and the guy says, he's a Jew. So he gave me the piece of bread and a piece of candy, and like he gave him a signal, you go to hell, you know. But I didn't realize what I realized after the name calling and all them. I was aware of that. But that guy, I guess maybe he didn't go for that, you know. And he was pretty fair. Everything was good the first, this was September. Everything was good like for a month or so. It was quiet. All of a sudden, when it was cold already, and we heard that they cut off like a half a dozen streets, and they stopped short at our doorstep, like our street, and they took the people out at night. And
did you hear about this?
No, we heard about this the next day. So my dad says, I better go see if my sister, you know, and her family. So we went up there, and it looked like they tried to cook coffee or something in a hurry, but everything was left on the stove, and they were gone. They took them out and never heard from them. And 90% was Jewish, 95% was Jewish neighborhood, and they stopped short next to our street.
Do you remember your parents' reaction to hearing this?
Well, we went up to the apartment where they lived, and we found they were gone. All we found was food looked like they were going to eat or take it with them, but they left it behind. It was left behind because they probably were hustled very fast. You
and
know.
What did your parents do when they saw that?
Well, my dad, he was really stunned. He was very overwhelmed. He was speechless, you know.
And your mother?
My mother, too. I think I saw my father cry. And, okay. And this was before they even closed the ghetto. Then around summertime, I think it was April or May, that they closed the ghetto with the barbed wires and all that. And they started taking everything away from the people and organizing big tailor shops, shoe factory shops, and machine shops and everything, and reorganized it like a war machine for the German army.
Can I go back to the time when, before they actually closed it up? Did anything else that you recall happen? Did anything else happen besides that time when you stopped
yes.
at your aunt's house?
Yes.
What else happened before they
I saw them
the streets?
In a public square, like there was a monument of Kosciuszko, which he was a Polish fighter and so on. I saw them dynamite that, and other all remnants from a Polish Polish fighters and heads of state and so on done away with it. Then I saw them picking mostly there was a lot of Jewish people. It was I say 60-70% that were wearing those Jewish caps and Jewish caps and chaletel, they used to call them.
What was that?
Chaletel, like you see the Orthodox Jews going to shul and with their kafiyas or whatever.
Kapote?
Kapote, yeah, right. Kapote and little beards. You know, most of them had beards. So they had no trouble in distinguishing who was a Jew and who wasn't. So they used to pick them off, and they had to do the labor cleaning up and all this and that. And some of them they took with them. Where they took them, you never saw those people again. You know.
Did you see any of these incidents?
Yes.
With
yes, I was. Well, I was. They didn't pick me because I was a kid, and they figured I wouldn't be able to do the work. You know. But they took any teenagers looked like 15, 16 and up, you know, they did. And that was it. And then...
What were your... Did your feelings begin to change about what it meant to have the Germans there?
No, not yet. Not yet, because I was too young. I was too young to comprehend, except I knew I was not something special, but I knew I was Jewish and I was getting different treatment. But I did not comprehend the seriousness of it.
Do you recall how your parents were in this period of time?
Frightened, afraid.
What did they talk about in terms of this?
They all talked about that they didn't realize that it was going to be this way because... they remember the Germans from the First World War, that they were not good angels, but they were human. They acted human. They didn't behave like barbarians. Well, this time they did, and they didn't know what to make of it. They went around all the apartments and everything, and everybody had to give up. Because tailors and everybody had knives and hammers and
tools.
And this and that, and everybody had to give it up, you know.
Did that include your father, too?
Yeah, that included my father. And
Do you remember the day that they came to...
Exact day and month?
Do you remember?
I remember the day, yes, because I was in the hallway going down, and they were coming up, you know, with their helmets and rifles and pistols in their hands and so forth. And he looked at me, and the guy said, let him go. He's a kid, you know, like... we had to turn in everything, just save a couple of small kitchen knives and the silverware or a couple of spoons and this and that, but everything else had to be turned in. And that's when they started organizing those sweatshops, like, you know. And my mother and father went to work. It took them about 3 months to organize all this. And by that time, they closed the ghetto. Oh, maybe more, maybe 4 months or so.
Remember when they closed the ghetto?
Yeah, it was either April or May, 1940.
And how old were you then?
I was going on 12 years, on 12.
Did something happen to get you to understand that the ghetto was being formulated, that walls were going up?
Two bridges.
How did you know this?
Two bridges were built. I still didn't comprehend the full thrust of it. Two bridges were built that went over the main street where the streetcars were going. That was not considered the ghetto. And we were fenced in. And in order to build two bridges on our street to go over and cross, and then about three blocks up, another bridge. Those were the two bridges where we could walk over from one side of the city to the other side of the city and go to work wherever people were going, you know.
At that point, was there free access between the ghetto and...
No more. There were guards at every gate. There were guards, and then they had guards walking up and down. Well, there was no more access to the outside,
to
beyond the ghetto. And things started getting very, very bad, you know, food-wise, economy-wise, and all that. And
how did you then get your food?
They had, food banks... food banks here, but they called it equivalent to like corporations, supermarkets. And every month they used to bring in so much food, and people registered and got so much of potatoes, so much of flour, so much bread. And that had to last for 30 days, you know. Well, the first couple months, okay, but then I realized that... people after a week or so didn't have no food left or so. And that's when the hunger started. And
what would they do? What sort of things
nothing,
would happen?
Nothing. You couldn't buy. Maybe you could buy something or so, but I don't remember that too much stuff that you could buy, because people did not have it. So, but a lot of people worked around the food stuff and all that. Well... so they had a little more than we did, you know, because, you know, what they say, if you were in the kitchen, if you're in the pot, you have a little more. But my dad went to work in a big tailor shop, like. My mother went to work in a big tailor shop also. And I didn't go to work at first. For about three, four months or so, and then I went to work. I worked in a tailor shop a little bit. Then I went to work in a machine shop. I worked there for I don't know how long, about 2-3 years or so.
Did they call you into work? Is that why you went to work?
Yeah, they picked me. You'd be big enough and strong enough to swing a sledgehammer or dig a shovel in a pit, you know.
Before you went to work, and your parents were already working, did you stay in your apartment?
I stayed home, and I boiled water, and she showed me how to cook, take a little flour and water, and make noodles.
Your mother?
Yeah, I made it, and I boiled the noodles and all that, but. I kept tasting and tasting. By the time they come home, there wasn't too much left. They felt bad, but you know, they loved me, you know. And things started going down after that. Can I take a drink of water?
I wanted to ask you, that was 1940. The first year of the ghetto was 1940.
The first year, I'll say, people made it through without being emaciated or so on. It was bad, but the first year was not livable, but it was a little bit... better than it was the second or the third. Then the second year we started thinking of the first year. The third year was then in 1942, see, like every 6 months they came in and they said, we want 5,000. The kids and the sick. Load on trucks. This 6 months later, they wanted 10,000 because they were bringing in from the surrounding areas within a couple hundred kilometers, emptying all the Jewish little places and bringing them into lodge. See, and as they were bringing them in, they sorted out the young and the old and the feeble, the sick and all that, hauled them away. Then in 1942, I remember it was late summer, a total curfew. They wanted like 50,000. They wanted the remnants left, the kids and the old and everybody that couldn't walk straight. Well, he appealed to Rumkowski, the eldest there, appealed to that Hans Frank and Bebop. How can you do that to us? We're doing all that work for you and everything else. How can you do that to us? You know. So they settled on 30,000, 10,000 less. So, but still, they took all the kids and all the hospitals, infirmaries, and the old and the sick and everything.
Did you know about this when it was happening? I mean, were you aware that all of these people were being taken away?
Yes, I was taken too. I was among them. We were herded onto trucks, very few trucks, but a lot of wagons, horses and wagons. And we were taken through, used to be a market square, bazaar used to call it. And the street name was Ogrodova, where they took my aunt and uncle and the kids. And they used to take us down, I'd say it was about 2-3 miles. There was a hospital there. I don't remember the name of a hospital or a gathering place. And that's where they unloaded us. We were there the whole afternoon. This happened early morning. We were there the whole daylight and the whole night, and the next day they were bringing in trucks and hauling the people away. And in fact, I was helping the older ones, you know, get on the truck. How is an old woman or an old man sick going to get on the truck? You should throw them on the truck. you know.
Who were you with at the time? Did you
Nobody.
Go yourself? You
Nobody,
were
just myself.
Mm-hmm.
I was taken from my mother and father. And there was a dozen other kids that were taken from the mothers and fathers. And as we were helping the older ones and the sick ones get onto the trucks, you know, and they were, they had, at that time they had, I don't know if they were SS or Army, but they also had the Jewish policemen help them, which they were involved, but it wasn't of their own free will, you know. They were policemen and they had to do their jobs or, so that time they had double trucks with hookups, you know, to the main trucks. And they had toolboxes underneath the trucks. And there was only not too many left. And like the last or before the last truck that went on, you know, and I says, my God, I don't like how they treat the people and what's going to happen. My intuition told me I got under that truck as the truck was leaving, under the truck between the two hookups and in that big toolbox that was hanging, and I got out of the gate. I don't remember how far I went, but I know that when the truck started going fast, I got out. I was lucky I didn't get run over.
The truck was traveling, and you were under the truck.
The truck was traveling out of the gate, and the truck had a hookup, like you see now on the and the roads, you see double trailers or so. And underneath there was a big a toolbox like that, whatever they had in there, tires or you know, jacks and this and that. But anyway, the truck started out slowly out of the gate, and I got under that truck between the two hookups, and I was just got behind that toolbox and all that, and I got out. Then I felt the truck started moving faster and faster, and I got out. Now that was a long walk from there to back home. Back home, I started walking. I was like numb. I realized it was bad. I was the only one in the street. All you saw was a German guard now and then, but they were across the street. I walked for, I don't know, maybe 15, 20 minutes or so, maybe more. I get to that marketplace. There's a dozen SS or Germans and all that. And there are two gallows, a dozen people hanging from the gallows. Me, a kid, a naive kid like me, I didn't stop, but I slowed down to look, you know. And they all turned around and looked at me. This was like, I'd say, maybe 100 feet away, you know. And they all turned around and looked at me, and I kept walking like I was God or something, and they just looked at me, and they were overwhelmed. I passed that market. Come down towards home, the guard stood not far from the corner because the wires and the wall was right there. I kept walking without any hesitation, looking straight ahead, and he looked at me, and I made it to the house. Yeah, come in the court, yeah, I know.
We'll continue this on the next tape. This is tape three, and Mr. Mangurten, you can continue the story that you were telling about getting back home.
I walked through that corner. The sidewalk was very narrow, and there was the guard standing maybe 5 feet away from me. But I kept walking, looking straight ahead.
Was this at the wall of the ghetto?
Yeah. And my house was like another couple hundred feet to get to the building. But this guy was a brown uniform guy, a Ukrainian guard. He looks at me and he couldn't make up his mind whether to say something to me or not. And where do I get the guts or the gumption? I had blonde hair that time. Maybe because I was young and had blonde hair. And anyway, I made it through. I went home. I come in the gate, the door, and the mothers and the fathers and the... What happened? What happened to my child? Some of them were 2 or 3 years old. And what happened to my child? And what? My mom and dad rushed me up to the apartment because people literally were killing themselves to know what happened to their... I told them. They kept me in the apartment for weeks because I was about the only one left out of tens of kids that were taken. Okay. Then I went to work. I worked till the liquidation. Every 6 months they were taking people out. There was very few left already, and before the war, 1944 was before the Jewish holidays, they liquidated the ghetto.
Before we talk about that, could we just go back, because I know that when the ghetto began, you were 12 years old, so I wondered what happened about your bar mitzvah.
Didn't have no bar mitzvah.
Was there any reminder at all about it?
Nothing. People even gave up meeting in homes for praying mincha or this or that. People even gave up on that too because the hunger, starvation was too great, and very little, you know, practice davening and all that because.
How about the holidays? Was there anything the holidays?
No, people were scrounging and whatever they could. There was no more like matzah or this or that. It was, okay.
What was the health care like?
Health care.
I mean, was there any kind of health care at all?
There was a little bit of health care, but not too much medicine. Mostly was people that... from eating salt and all that, we're all blowed up and all that, and just punch a hole and get rid of the water, you know, so on. But God forbid if you had an illness or something that could have been cured with antibiotics or something, it was non-existent. So,
what about, was there any... There was no schooling going on?
No. The first year was a little bit of school, high this school and all that, but then it whittled away, you know.
So the second and third years, how would you describe them?
Very bad. Total starvation. Total annihilation, abuse, the what do you call humiliation? Total.
What was your clothing? Were you able to get clothing?
Well, as far as while we're there, we still had from the old. We patched and sewed and this and that. It was we didn't go naked, you know.
What sort of heat did you have in the winter, in the cold weather?
Well, we had sweaters, homemade sweaters, or whatever from before the war, and people were making some at home and this and that, you know, and like neighbors, whoever died away, people took their stuff and reused it. Nothing was thrown away. Everything was reused and so forth.
Did you have any heat source?
Heat?
Heat.
We were turned on walls and poles and everything till because we had like shanties in the courtyards and all. Everything was torn down. Walls that separated courtyards and all. And that's all a little bit of heat in the stoves. And but it was still better than at least you stayed in your own place and you slept in your own straw bed. You know.
Were there any other people in your apartment during that period?
No, just me, my mother and father. Because, like I said, the others were taken away from the beginning. They had no chance. But the best, well, from there, when they liquidated the ghetto.
Tell me about that.
I went to Auschwitz.
Tell me about the liquidation of the ghetto. How did you know that was happening?
Well, the Jewish officials and the Jewish police were going around with megaphones and announcing, everybody come down and assemble in the courtyard, and everybody is leaving. You know, we're going to a place where we will work and have housing, food, and everybody will get a loaf of bread on the way for the duration of the journey, and so on. And there was no nothing. I was hiding in a cupboard under the one little place there.
How did that happen?
There was a little addition to a building there, and there was a cupboard underneath that the janitor kept his tools and all that. And there was the woman and the man that owned the buildings, me and a couple others, we were hiding in that cupboard.
Did your parents know that you were hiding there, or did they tell you to?
All of a sudden I hear my mother and my dad calling me. Well, after a couple minutes, I said, I want to go out. And they were waiting for me. At least they gave them time to wait till they find me. And we went together. We went together to the train station and got in the box cars. They loaded us on wagons, horse and wagons, went to the train stations. We got into box cars.
When you saw you were getting into box cars, what was the feeling that you had?
My feeling? I was aware that something was going on, but the older people, they knew. They had inklings.
What was their behavior at the time that you were getting on the box cars?
Numbness. Loaded into box cars, I don't know how many people, but we could hardly turn around in there.
What time of year was that?
It was summertime. It was before Rosh Hashanah. It was hot. And we had a several-hour ride to Auschwitz, Oświęcim. We didn't know what it was, Auschwitz. We didn't hear about Auschwitz or nothing. But we got there.
But wait, before you got there, what was that? I want to hear more about that trip. What you remember about the trip, what it felt like to be in the boxcar.
After, I'll say after an hour or so, it was hot. you couldn't sit down. People were standing, shoulder to shoulder. There was no sanitary. I think they throw it in a bucket, like. And there was no sanitary. I remember I was a kid, the mothers blocking the daughters and the daughters blocking the mothers and all that. It was awful. It was hot, smelly, and awful. At one point, after riding for a good while, the train stopped somewhere, and the Jewish policeman, jumped out and told him where to dump the bucket and all that. But it was immaterial. It was smelly and hot and all that.
Did you have any food or water?
No,
in there?
No food, no water. People were fainting. It was awful. It was awful. Me, I could hack it because of my age, you know. But I was crying a lot.
Were you with others that you knew from your street?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, sure. And, there weren't too many kids left from my courtyard because they were all taken away during that 1942 curfew, what they call. And, in fact, I just saw those two, Frank and Bebo, on the History Channel. They had Polish, history, they call, back in history.
How long did that trip take?
Trip took, I'd say, 3-4 hours, if not more. I don't remember exactly.
And then what
because
happened?
Because that was Oświęcim. That was Silesia, already. You know, southern Poland or East Poland. So we came into it was Birkenau. Is the big sign, Arbeit macht frei. Work makes free, makes you free. And okay.
When the train stopped and they opened the doors,
they
what
opened
did you
the
see?
Doors. They started hauling, and they were their SS, and they had Jewish commandos. They called them Canada, specifically for that purpose, to get the people out of the trains and get their belongings afterwards and all that. And if you couldn't get out of the train fast enough, you was pushed out, you know, thrown out. And the guys with whips, the SS with whips, and the dogs. People were overwhelmed. We didn't know. We knew it was bad, but we were just overwhelmed, the other people. Women assembled to the, women and children to the right, men and over 18 to the left. So I was with my father, and my mother went with her sister. She had a little girl about 4 or 5 years old, and the women and children went first. And I was in line with my dad, maybe 75 feet behind, so. And I watched my mother and aunt and the baby going past the selection. There was like a dozen of them, you know, with Mangala was there. I didn't realize it was who he was.
How did you know, though?
I didn't know. But he was, can I move my arm or so?
Sure.
And he was, he had a whip, a rawhide whip in his hand about 2 feet long, the softer part, like this. And he was selecting people to go straight to the gas chamber, which I didn't know it was the gas chamber. And I see my mother pass them. I bolted away from my father and start running past the guards towards my mother. I didn't realize what it was. And he cracked that whip over my shoulder like, come here. He looked at me. I had blonde hair and blue eyes, you know. How old are you? I think I told him 18 or 17 or something like that, and I was fairly tall for my age. He looked at me, and his eyes were telling me something like he felt sorry for me. And he says, "You're old enough. Get back over there with the men." So I went back over there with the men. And then me and my father, the men came in. They had us in another barrack where we had to, the people had to take their watches and rings and jewelry and the clothes off and everything and pile them up nice and neat yet because we're going to need come back and so we can find everything again. And meantime, I saw buckets full of watches and rings and what have you. Okay. And they gave us the striped uniforms. And we come in to camp, the ones that were selected to work.
And that was your father and
that
you.
That was my father and me. And we were to get, I was sent to a different block about four or five blocks up. I remember it was block number 27, and my father was in block 9 or 10 or something like that. And you couldn't walk or get out of the barrack or walk or this or that. And, 2 days, 3 days, I'm still with my father there. He's there, but I was... one time I snuck in line and got an extra little portion of supposedly soup or so. I had a little cup. And I went and walked down that embankment, that road supposedly between the barracks, and went down and looked for my father and gave it to him. And he was so scared, he says, "How are you going to get back? You're going to get killed and this and that." He already hasn't shaved for 4 or 5 days or so. And he looked off. I gave him that soup. He took a little bit and he said, "You finish." I said, "No." He said, "You drink it." And I went back to him. About 2 days later, they take him away. Where they took him, I don't know. He wasn't there no more. And then, about 2 days later, there's a group of civilian Germans come, and all of a sudden they get us out of the barrack, assemble in that yard there next to the barrack, naked and all that. And the guy announces that we need 400 men to work in the coal mine, strong. But nobody believed it. Nobody believed it. We just figured, gas chamber again. Oh, let me go back 1 second. When we came into camp, there were some people there that were there before me, maybe a month or two or three, and they... we started assembling and loafing like in the yard, and this guy, one guy says, "When did you come in?" I said, "We come in yesterday, you know, and all." And how about my mother? So I told him my mother went with her sister and little girl. He says, "See those chimneys over there and the smoke? That's where you..." Just blunt like that. That's where they went. But I still had my dad, you know, and so on. So something told me, my intuition told me that it is true. They're looking for 400 men because they were looking for healthy, not emaciated, to work in a coal mine. So my intuition told me, go. Go. About 2 hours later, we were getting an extra piece of bread. And a little, I don't know what it was, coffee or whatever it was, we gobbled it up. Got on the truck, was like an hour's drive. We get to this place, two new barracks, without wires, nothing, except a couple, half a dozen regular Army and one SS camp commander. We get off and a lot of screaming and this and that, and the camp commander says, "You go in there, behave yourself, and wait till you go to work and all that, and everything will be okay."
Were you with other people from
your
hometown? Yeah,
from Lodge.
There were a lot of people
from
Lodge
that I knew. In fact, I met one in 1984 at the Concord. We had a reunion, a couple that were worked with. And in fact, his name in Polish was Fagot. Well, Fagot is not a pretty name, so he says, "My name is Fanot." Now, with an N. Okay. So we were there for several weeks, maybe 2-3 months, and we had it like a regular work camp. We worked in the coal mines, worked at night. I forgot how many hours, 10 or 12 hours. And in the morning, we come up from the coal mine, we assembled, and it was a Ukrainian, about 2 or 3 Ukrainian guards that were accompanying us. But me, I always tried to be on the outside because I was smaller than the others, so that they could see me, you know. So this Ukrainian guard, he's next to me with his rifle and all. He looks at me, and he says, "Where are you from?" In Polish. So I says, "I'm from Lodge." He says, "Yeah?" He says, "You remember 1942, the name of the curfew was Sperr means a curfew, like that." I says, "Of course I remember. I was there, and me, like a little naive kid, said, I ran away from there and come back home, you know." He says, "Yeah, you was lucky." And me, again, like naive, I says, "What did they do with those people?" Didn't say it, but he showed me. And that's it. We kept on walking and walking. But I made sure that I'm on the outside. It was cold. It was cold already. Then we go to another little camp. That was
In the camp that you were with the coal mine, what was the name of that place?
Rybnik. Charlottengruber in German. Rybnik. It was a little town. In fact, there's a fellow just died. He lived in that little town. That was Silesia near Katowice, Bendin, Sosnowiec.
How long were you there in Rybnik?
We were there a couple months, 2 or 3 months or so, and I don't know what happened, but they took us up to another little camp there was a Russian POW camp, and we were there closer to the mine because it was getting too long to walk to the mine, you know. So we moved up there. Forgot the name of that, what the place was. We were there, and we were right across from the Russian camp. So we weren't getting enough to eat, but we were getting more than Auschwitz or any of the other camps because they said it was already closed, 1945 already, and they needed the coal, they needed production. So we worked with the civilian population that went down with us. They were the overseers and the big, engineers and all that. So guys even, they used to bring sandwiches from home, just like regular. He looked around, made sure nobody was there, and he slipped me a piece, maybe 2-3 bites or so. Well, I'll tell you, 2-3 bites, to me it was a half a bite. Okay.
How long did you do that in that place?
I don't remember. It was another couple of months or so, but it was very cold, very cold. And we had already half a dozen young SS there, you know, taking care of us. And there was already a fence around that because it was older than the other ones. So one day, we come home from work in the morning, and they had like a tub with a long pipe and running water, like, so you could have maybe 10, 12 people at the same time, you know, cold water and all that. Well, they were marching, you know, stumping their feet, cold and everything. The SS, the guards, here I come on, I take everything off except I had my pants, you know, my torn and whatever, and walk over to that to that tub with water and wash myself. And they stood maybe 25, 30 feet away from me. They look at me and they talk to each other and laugh like, look at him, he's a wise guy or something, you know. But
well, then why did you, how did it happen that you left that place?
No, wait a minute. So I didn't, I got washed and in the cold and all that, and went back in and put on just that one little garment, whatever it was, that was nothing to warm up. And then some big wig shots coming in. His name was Alfred Rosenberg. He was second hand to Hitler. Rosenberg, not Jewish, that's really something, you know. Had General Rosenberg. I wasn't too far away from him. I should have never been where I was because I could have gotten shot right then and there. But anyway, I was naive enough to do it. And he must have come down and told him that they were going to have to be evacuated. So we went from there. They put us on trucks and we went to Mauthausen. Oh, this was, I guess, January or February or so. Went to Mauthausen. We were there to be liquidated, but they didn't have the means fast enough to do it. And that they didn't want to shoot us and leave the corpses for the Allies, I guess, to...
When you came into Mauthausen, what was your impression when you arrived there?
I saw killers were killing horses for horse meat. Who was getting the meat? I don't know, because I know the inmates weren't getting the horse meat, so they must have been killing them for themselves, you know.
Who were you with when you went to Mauthausen?
Oh, I was by myself, just a bunch of guys that we were from that little camp. We're killing horses, and we were put in a certain place called quarantine. We were getting ready to liquidate us.
Okay, we'll continue on the next tape.
Okay.
This is tape four, and Mr. Mangurten, you had just arrived in Mauthausen. when we finished the last tape. What, again, were your impressions when you first arrived, when that day when you arrived in Mauthausen? What did you find there?
Masses of people. They put us into a place they called the quarantine. And we were awaiting elimination there.
Did you know that at the time?
No. But as we, the second day or the third day, people that were there, and the like special groups that worked and all that, this is your last stop. You know, they also had gas chambers there and chimneys, ovens.
And who were the people who worked in the
block houses?
No, who were the people who took care of the barracks?
Or the crematorium?
No, the barracks.
They were usually political, German political prisoners. Except a few Jewish couples, you know.
Did you have a buddy there at all?
No. They had political German prisoners. They were either Germans or Volksdeutsche, but they had those triangles, bless you. Those triangles or something on their, for one. Each one represented something. Union or communists or against the Reich or whatever. You know, they were the in charge of the capos, and they had the authority with the whips or baseball, equivalent to baseball bats or whatever they felt like it, you know. If a guy woke up on the wrong side and he wanted to get worked up, so he slugged a few on the head that he never come back, you know. Just later until you died.
What was your experience with them?
My experience, I was not in the mainstream there when they brought us in. But since they couldn't fit us in, you know, for annihilation as fast as they wanted to, an order came to from another camp named Melk, M-E-L-K. It was a fairly big camp to send us there because they could use us working in the mountains, digging holes in the mountains, and we had those coolies cars there, you know, coolies railroad tracks and all that. We were digging holes and hollowing the mountains to make factories. For what they were going to do there, I don't know, but I guess it was like munition factories or something, you know, parts.
How were conditions there as compared to Mauthausen?
We come into that camp from Mauthausen to Melk. Mauthausen, there was nothing there except no food, no water, nothing, you know, for 3-4 days. So there was really nothing there. Those who died, and those who didn't were going to be put to death, but they couldn't keep up fast enough. And we saw people working on mountains there, you know, with the hammers, making little ones out of big ones, stone and this and that. Anyway, we went to that place, Melk, and it was cold. We assembled like a roll call, you know. We stood there all night, till much into the day and all that. And all of a sudden I see the commander that was with us where we worked in the coal mine, you know. And like I said, I always wanted to be the first one so I can be seen. So we're standing there, and he counts, and then another biggish shot comes up, and he gives him the report, so many, and it checks out and all this and that. And he looks at me. He says, "How did you get here?" You know. I stood there. I was numb. I couldn't go to the bathroom, nothing. I just let go. I had to go to the bathroom. We stood there, I don't know for how long, but we couldn't move. That's how cold it was. Finally, they let us into the barrack. And there was a barrack with about, I'd say, 50 kids and over, from 12 to teenagers like me, you know. I didn't like what I saw, because every day they came in and took kids out. I don't know where they took them or what, but most of them you didn't see again. So I asked this one guy, I says, "I want to go to work and be with the older men." He said, "Okay, go ahead," you know. And that saved my life too. So I went to work. We walked about 2-3 miles to the train station. It must have been 20 below zero. Whatever wooden shoes we had or whatever, it was nothing. You know, my feet after a week or so were frozen. When I did sleep a little bit, I had needles in my feet. I couldn't sleep, nothing. So they had a building there. It was right next to the Danube, Blue Danube. They had a building there where there was at least, I'd say, about 30, 40 German SS and other guards and all that. And this commander that was with us when we worked in the coal mine, he said, "If anybody wants to commit suicide, you come and see me and I'll shoot him personally." But he didn't do it. Yeah. In fact, I think he was of Yugoslav or Croatian descent. He looked like he was in his 40s or so, you know. But he knew me good, because in that little camp where we worked in coal mine, come Sunday afternoon, we were getting food from the Russian camp. And he said, "Take anything you can, you know, put your hands on." We had plenty to eat. This is true. We had, instead of one little slice of bread, we had a quarter of a bread. Boiled potatoes, soup, you know, they took it from the Russians. Okay, after we ate, it was Sunday afternoon we were getting good meals. Sunday afternoon after we ate was in the afternoon or so. There was like 4 or 5 young German, I don't know if they were SS or plain soldiers or what. They come out with a football, you know. Now they need guys to play ball. So they took a half a dozen of us and made a team out.
Now, was this back in Rybnik?
In Rybnik.
Okay.
And made two teams, like, you know, us against them. Now, here, we play ball and all, but guys were afraid, what if you kick somebody? What, you know, so now, in fact, a couple of them did get kicked and so, and they expected to get shot, that the guy would pull. But they didn't even wear the guns. And that commander's standing there laughing, you know, like, unbelievable.
So you met that commander again in the...
So in Melk, in that camp, there was 2 or 3 buildings together, like, and that was the commandantur, they called, and everything. And we come home one morning from work, you know. I couldn't even move a finger, or my feet were. So I says, "I'm going to go in and find him into that building and tell him I can't take it no more. My feet are a piece of ice, and whatever happens, I don't care, you know." I come in, and I happen to hit the right door. I knock on the door. I open the door. He says, "Herr Ein." He thought it was somebody else. I open the door. He looks at me. He gets up from the chair. "Who do you think you are, and what are you doing here?" And, you know, hollered from the top of his lung. But he didn't holler enough for the other soldiers or somebody to hear. The guy looked at me like he must have had maybe a couple boys or kids at home, you know. He says, "What do you want?" But to go into that building, I went through maybe 3-4 guards. I went straight without hesitation. They looked at me and they thought, like, who is this guy coming in here? I didn't care. He says, what do you want? I says, I want to go work in the kitchen with the other kids, because there was like a dozen younger kids my age working in the kitchen peeling potatoes and this and that. He says, I can't go. Look at my feet. Look at me. You know, I can't go. He says, okay, go in the kitchen. Tell him I sent you. Well, for me to go through the yard, I don't think I could make it 100 feet. I says, no, you come on and you watch me go through the yard. Like he was somebody I knew, like Mark, you know. How could you talk to a guy like that? But there was something there. His says, okay, go ahead. I come in and I says, Commander, I forgot his name, sent me in, and he told me to for you to put me to work and all that. So he opens the door and he goes and he waves like with his hand and all that. Okay, I was there for about 2-3 weeks, maybe longer. It was like heaven. I was eating raw potatoes. I was eating, sneaking a little bit of cabbage, sneaking whatever it was, grass, whatever it was. I was sneaking a little bit, and I'm a chayil, you know. Okay.
So
but I forgot, it was still cold after that. Well, assemble again. No, before we assembled, I was transferred to another detail, work detail. We had to go down to the train station there near the camp, maybe a mile or two, and pick up the dead from the passenger trains that the British and Americans and shut up the train, and you know, there was many killed, and we had to bring them into camp and lay them out and all what they did. I don't know.
Did you hear the bombings at that time? Were you able to hear the bombings from Melk?
Yeah, and in fact, on that building where I went into that SS, I went on the second floor and sat on a windowsill and watched the fighter jets over the Danube fighting. What am I doing sitting there watching the fighter jets? I could have gotten killed, you know. But they didn't attack the building, and they didn't attack the camp. Things I did that was unbelievable. So after a while, get orders, evacuation again, because they were closing in, the Russians or the English or the
Americans. Before you go to that, these dead bodies that you picked up, where did you bring them to?
Near the crematorium. They had a makeshift crematorium, and they had ditches that, but the Germans were put in the ditches. They didn't burn them, and you know, and cover them, put whatever on top. But it was anyway. It was already towards the end, so they did go a little bit easier on us, because they were afraid of leaving too much evidence. So
how long were you there? I mean,
I don't know. It had to be at least a couple months or so.
And where did you go from there?
From there, that was from Mauthausen to Melk. From there, they put us on trains. We were going to go to Gross Rosen or to Reisenstadt. That was in Czechoslovakia already. We got in open box cars. It must have been 20 below zero. In open box cars, and we come into Prague, Czechoslovakia. We stood there because trains couldn't go no more. The British or the Americans were closing, or the Russians, British and Russians were closing in. We stood there for several hours in that market square light, and civilian people, because we looked out, you know, but we had real SS and those brown uniforms, Ukrainians with us, but civilian people were coming and throwing over thermos bottles with coffee, chocolate, hot chocolate, and sandwiches and everything. This SS officer, like equivalent of a lieutenant or something, and he drew his guns and he says, "Anybody going near those Jews again, will be shot. I'm going to shoot you like dogs. Get away. You know, these are Jews here." And the people reluctantly backed away. But several did caught a little bit of coffee, a sandwich, this and that. We stood there for several hours. We went back to Melk, because that was the closest rail station there. I'm sorry. We went back to Melk. We were there for 2-3 more weeks or
Did
so.
Did you work again? Huh? Did you work again during
no,
this?
No, no work. Everything was suspended already. And they were punishing a couple of them. Escaped. They caught him, brought him back. They strung him up on the wall and poured cold water on him. You know, they froze to death, and just like crucifying him, and to for everybody to look, and no more escape. Like I saw the picture they have here, escape from Sobibor. Did you see that picture?
No, I didn't. Where did they? Did you have any experience with any suicides?
Oh, yeah, there was, we went, every day we went to work in a coal mine, in the shafts, every day, two or three of them jumped in, you know.
What did they jump into?
To the shaft.
Oh, right into the
shaft. That was like, 400 or 500 feet deep, maybe more equivalent, about 700 feet deep. But anyway, that commander, he says, anybody wants to, it was a different one, it wasn't him, but a different one. He said, anybody wants to commit suicide, come and see me and I'll do the job. Because he says, I don't want nobody in my camp committing suicide.
When okay. You were finished with Melk?
No. So from there, we stayed there a while longer. We go back to Mauthausen. Because they tried to get rid of us, but they couldn't. Somebody came, like Himmler gave orders already. This must have been February or March, not to leave any corpses laying evidence, because they didn't tell us, but it wouldn't be long. So from there, after 2-3 weeks or so, we were starved, no food, nothing. Assembled us, oh, we were, I don't know, couple thousand, 3,000, maybe more, I don't know how many, assembled us, and we marched from Mauthausen to the woods, Gunskirchen. And maybe half of us got there to that Gunskirchen, the wood was woods. We come into those woods, there was Hungarian soldiers and Russian soldiers, and it was a mixture, like woods thrown in, and that's where they're going to finish us up.
You
know.
Do you remember marching during the day and the night?
It was during the day into the night.
Into the night.
During the day into the night. So it had to be at least 15, 20 miles or so, you know. And they had a couple barracks there, but they didn't have no ovens. They didn't have no gas chambers, nothing. And people were succumbing to... starvation and cold and everything else long enough, you know, without them killing. But they only had the home police guarding us, you know. It was, so it was towards the end. But I'll tell you, we used to come out in like mornings or so. It had to be Russians, because I don't think the regular inmates would have done that. They took corpses, you know, that they cut the rump pieces off the rumps, you know, and they ate them. They ate him. It had to be the Russians, because they didn't eat for weeks or so, you know. Okay. Was used to it, every saw it every day for days, you know.
You saw that daily?
I didn't see them do it, but we saw the corpses laying there with pieces of rumps missing from their heaviest part, you know. Okay. And I forgot how long we were there, 2 or 3 weeks or a month. All of a sudden, I see a Army Jeep, they used to call them, two or three of them get into Beetle Jeep, and one of them carries a white flag. And we were standing there already watching them.
Were these
them.
Germans?
Germans, in uniform. The ones that were helping guard us. But they were officers, like, in charge. And they take off. It was like 3-4 of them. We stand by the gates already and all that, but the guards, those home guards, they didn't bother us. They just said, take it easy there, don't... In about a half hour or so, or an hour, they come back with the flag drawn and all that. And one of them was an officer. He stands up in that beetle. He's giving us a speech. Now, stay behind the wires, behind the walls, you know, behave yourself, because the British and American troops are coming in. They wouldn't know who you are, and they're going to shoot you. So stay there and behave, you know. What they meant mainly is stay there and give them time to, anyway, people started running out of the gates and all that, like a flood, you know, like a, what do you call it? I forgot, just like saw the other day in Africa coming towards Clinton. Stampede. But something told me, stay back, don't... I stayed back, but then I did get out, and I start walking. I didn't know where, because it was woods. Here I see maybe half a dozen of them standing near a hole.
Half a dozen of who?
German uniforms. They were young and old, discarding their uniforms into the hole and putting civilian pants on, but they throwing rifles in there and whatever, but they still kept the... pistols, you know, and they had bicycles. I should have never even gone near them. I went looking for something to eat, you know. But anyway, they discarded and all that. They got on the bicycles and they left as civilians. And I kept walking, following them, because I figured they must be going towards a highway or something. And it was already evening, got out towards the highway, and I see tanks and half tracks and sticking out with helmets and this and that. And, you know, I had the striped uniform. I was like a kid. And a guy stopped and looked at me, and soldiers kept going. And one guy threw me was a pack of cigarettes, but I didn't know I bit into the cigarettes. I thinking it was candy. So we start walking down the highway, and we got into some farmer. And there was on top of the farm, on go up with the ladder, that they must have been held up there, and they had food there, chocolate and all kinds of German canned food and this and that. So they must have taken off, and so everybody started. There was like a half a dozen of us, you know, older ones. I was the youngest one. No matter where I went, I was the youngest one, and they started eating. Chocolate food, there was canned food, ham and everything. They started eating. Before you know, I take a look, the guy is laying there dying. The guy is laying there dying. Something told me. I saw a can of something. I opened up, it was like carnation milk, because there were a couple of shandies. They're full of Red Cross stuff, but we never got it. They must have kept them for themselves. I open up this can, didn't know, but I tasted it was like milk, and I took a couple of small sips at a time, and I felt my stomach inside churning like a drill, you know. But anyway, I didn't finish. I had another couple sips and all that, and then downstairs, the older guys, whoever made it in the living, that was a woman, and an old man, and they made tea or coffee, you know, and and I had a little bit of tea, and then she made soup or something. And but still, the next day I could eat a little more. So I.
Where were you by then?
This was maybe a couple miles from Gunskirchen, from the woods, on the main highway. The next day or so, we got out, you know, and whoever could, we start walking down the highway, and American Red Cross trucks with the Red Cross signs on it were picking us up and taking us towards Linz. Linz, and about 4 or 5 miles down the road was an airport, but it was a military airport and German barracks, housing and all that. It was real nice. And they made a hospital out of it for us and all that. Still, I was already a week later, and I was in the hospital, I don't know how long, for weeks, many weeks.
What was your illness? Did they tell you? Did they tell you what your illness
dehydration, was? Emaciation, and what have you. But after a week, I felt already better. I went, scrounged up some potatoes, took 4 bricks, lit a fire, and I cooked potatoes. And I had a potato, and another guy had a potato, and so. So we were already on the way to recovery. But in that hospital, I even helped dozens and dozens and dozens of bags from eating. People were eating, you know, on their own without permission, nothing. And no sooner they put something in their stomachs, then that was it. And people weighed, I must have weighed less than 40 pounds, you know. But take older people, they weighed maybe 70, 80, a 200-pound man weighed 60, 70 pounds, and you didn't have nothing but bones. You know, you couldn't keep up with the... Did a good job. You didn't need no gas chambers or so. Did a good job then.
We'll continue this on the next tape. This is tape 5. Mr. Mangurten, we were talking about your hospitalization in Linz after the liberation. And tell me what happened after that.
After the hospital, those who were good enough, you know, well enough, they took us there. There were two little complexes, like... It was like a little apartment building. They were like 2 miles apart that German officers lived there because across the street, those two little buildings, they were like 2 or 3 miles from the city.
From Linz.
Mm-hmm. Were also... barracks, German soldier barracks, but they picked up all the ones that were well enough and could eat and live on their own, and took us to those two buildings and made like two little camps out of them.
And what was that called?
Hag was one name, and the other one was Hart, H-A-R-T, I think. And across the street was the Panzer Division, American soldiers, 11th Army Panzer Division. And they had German... After a month or so, or 2 months, they were getting ready a big camp that was a big apartment complex, also where German soldiers lived with their families, and they got them ready. And when they got them ready, they took us and many, many hundreds more that they were bringing in and made a big DP camp, which I have a picture from it. You'll see.
And what was the name of that?
Bindemichel. And it was like a little shtetl, you know. It was like a little shtetl, Bindemichel.
And what did you do while you were at Bindemichel?
In Bindemichel, people right away started grabbing to their own trades. Tailor, shoemaker, dressmaker, whatever, carpenter. People started grabbing those little things on their own and keep busy. Me, I went across the street where the military was stationed.
The American military?
Yeah, American military. And I says, I want to work in the kitchen where all our good food is. So I befriended this guy. He was a sergeant, Donald Johnson. He was 21 years old at that time. He was from Iowa, a farm boy. And he took a liking to me. Very religious. And, okay, you're going to work here. But I didn't understand what he was saying, but he pointed a finger like sort of, I mean, if you don't behave, I'm going to whip you. Something to that effect. I didn't understand, but I could tell by his actions and all that, where, you know, GIs, everybody had good times with women, this and that. Not this guy. Not, he was very religious, and he sort of took a liking to me. He watched me. Guy gives me a bottle of brandy one time. I start drinking a bottle of brandy. He saw me, and he grabbed that bottle out of my hand, and he says, I'll kill you. You don't have to kill yourself. You know, like, he was mad. You didn't get killed then. You weren't, you know. And it's, I'm glad he did. And then come after breakfast, make good pancakes and syrup and all that. And I used to go across the street. We still lived in them two little camps, and bring maybe 2-3 dozen pancakes and bacon and home fries. They wouldn't even let me come in. Everybody was grabbing, you know. We had lots of fun, you know. But still at night, there was like a dozen of us or so, and we assembled outside that little building. It was nice and warm. The moon was out and all that.
Well, what would you do? Would you...
Talk and cry. Talk and cry. Think of this and that. So, and after a couple of months, like I said, they evacuated us into that big DP camp, and we were there, and everybody was going about their business already, tailors and this and that and this and that, and and I was working in the kitchen, doing dishes and eating pancakes and what have you. Okay, 1946, rumor started that Mrs. Eleanor Roosevelt, in fact, she was there. I didn't know who it was, but that she was promoting in all teenagers, you know, put under the UNRWA jurisdiction and go to the United States. Go to America.
Did you see her, even though you didn't recognize her? Did you see
her? No, I saw her, but I didn't know who it was until later they said, that's Roosevelt's wife, you know. Oh, I'm sorry. So anyway, A month later, start registering, right? I already passed my 17th birthday, was past May. 11-5, which is backwards here, November. So I registered, and this one guy says, I made myself 2 years younger because it might take 2 years before. So he said, go ahead, you make yourself 2 years younger too. It's not a crime. Okay, so I said 16 instead of 18, you know. And in fact, it was true because I would have been 18, past 18, and I would have been left behind, which I would have gone maybe a year later or so. But I didn't want to wait. So anyway, we went to registered, and in September, we leave and we go to Germany, to Munich. We go to Munich, Funkaserner was the name. There was a transit camp, like. We were there for, I don't know how long. I meet this fellow, also from Lodge and all that. He knew my dad, knew my family, knew me and all that. And he lived like maybe a mile or two away in Felda, I think they called it. You know, there was the Danube there going. So he took me up there, you know, and I met some more people from home that knew. And this one guy comes on, and he says, how's your father? I says, what are you talking about? I saw him in Germany in Landsberg. That was after the war. Landsberg, that was where Hitler was in prison. It was also a DP camp made out of. So anyway, from Munich, we a couple days.
Wait, hold on 1 minute. Who saw him in Landsberg?
He was sort of like a neighbor, you know. Where he knew they belonged to the same outfit, Taylor Union or whatever. And of course, he knew my father as well as I did, if not better, or longer. And so anyway.
And what was he telling you?
He said he saw my father in Landsberg, in that DP camp, you know, after the war. So we leave from Munich. So it happened a couple days later, we leave Munich to Bremen. From Bremen, we take a train and go to Bremerhaven to get on the boat. September or October, the 2nd or whatever, to get on the boat. Me, that was the British zone. Me, I get outside and I see a British soldier near a truck and all that, and I says, I couldn't speak English, you know, but a word or two or so. I want to go Landsberg here, there. And the way he expressed himself, that's where I'm going, you know. And I went. I went and I missed the boat. But I didn't care. I missed the boat. I come back about a month later because I was there for about a week. I made some more people that were neighbors, and I says, Anja, Adela, they knew my father as well as I did. He must have seen somebody else that looked like your father, you know. But go to Bergen-Belsen. There's a lot of people there, and maybe he's there. So I went to Bergen-Belsen, spent 2 days there, met people that knew my, no. I went to Augsburg, another little camp or so. Nobody saw. So after a month or so, I hitchhiked back to Bremen, but I missed a boat. And then there was a merchant marine strike, you know. So I was there for 2 months, and we had a good time, you know.
Where did you stay?
It was also a little transit camp near Bremerhaven. You know, we stayed there. It was like a dorm. In fact, I found pictures that I saw people from. I didn't even know them. You know, but I don't know what I did with them. But that's all we did, is take pictures, you know, waited for the boat to strike over, this and that, and this and that. There was a Mrs. Block. She was like a social worker, but she was in uniform. She was from New York.
For whom did she work?
Pardon me?
For whom did she work?
She worked for the United States government, for the government. She didn't work for anybody except the government. But she was also a social worker there to us, and we spent the time. We went to town. Went to town. First thing the German people did is clean up the roads, the passes, make the roads passable. And when we got on streetcars or in army jeeps or trucks, we drove for maybe 4 or 5 miles, and all you saw was shells, bombed out building, and all that. But the precision was so good that we went toward the heart of town. There was a church in the market square. Our church wasn't touched except a few scratches from falling debris. Oh, I'm sorry. A few scratches from falling debris. So we were there until December, first week of December, and the strike is all that. We get on the boat. We get to Bremerhaven. We get on the boat. The name of the boat was Marine Marlin. And we left Bremerhaven. And we rode, after a day, all of a sudden the boat starts rocking. You know, we hit the English Channel. Past the English Channel, the boat started rocking. People sick and all that. So there was one guy, he was working on the boat. He says, Here's a lemon and an orange. Eat this, you know, put the lemon on your lips and this and that. So, well, it helped me. Then I went back. I says, hey, give me some more. I'll give it to to the people. He says, I'll tell you what, I'll give you half a dozen oranges. I'll give you half a dozen lemons. Sell them for 10 cents a piece. I didn't know what he said, but he showed me a dime, you know, and he showed me a nickel, showed me a quarter. He says, tell him to give you this for that. And, you know, a lot of people took the oranges or the lemons, and they felt better because, oh, the seasickness was something terrible. But we made it. It took us 9-10 days, and then all of a sudden the ship calms, and we started hitting towards New York, and we started seeing bridges, lights, neon signs.
What were you feeling when you saw those signs?
I couldn't wait to get off the boat, you know, participate. It was a feeling of, the first feeling when we saw an American soldier, every one of them was a God, you know, like you say, God help us, we want to see God and all. We saw a God in every one of them because they were the first GIs off the battlefields. And I'll tell you, in this little camp after the war, that hog, where they assembled every day for several weeks, they brought German prisoners that they were taking out to work, clean places and debris and pick up strewn vehicles and machinery and all that. And there was a hallway. A hallway could hold maybe 25, 30 people. So I come in. I want to go through the hallway. And I hear Polish and Yiddish from the uniformed guy. So I went over. And I says to him in Polish, what are you, German or Polish? How come you speak Yiddish? He didn't think I was Jewish. So there's a Jewish slang. I says, "Di bist an Amchu." You know what Amchu is? slang for young, and he looks at me, and he says, yeah. I says, what are you doing in a German uniform, you and this other guy? In fact, I mean, they were from Lodz, too. So what happened? When the Germans invaded, they fled over towards Russia, you know. But they got caught before they went into Russia, so they declared right away that they were Aryans, you know. They were Aryans, and the Germans grabbed them and put uniforms on them, and you'll be good enough to die on the Russian front for us. But they made it and come back. So
now you're in New York, or you are arriving.
No, this is still... This is still. So the guy, I had several packs of cigarettes in my room upstairs. I had chocolate, I had cookies and crackers, whatever. And I bring some cigarettes down, cookies and this, and I give it to them. You know, this sergeant, I forgot his name, not the one that took a liking to me, but this other guy, he grabs me. He didn't hurt me, but he says like what I could feel and... they were killing you last week, the other day, and now you're giving them cigarettes and food. So I tried to explain to him the situation. He wouldn't even hear because he was off the battlefield, too. Anyway, I went up to the building, to the room and all that, and he come up, and he brought an interpreter with him, and I told the story and all that. He said, well... okay, but I didn't feel that way. You know, my feelings were different.
Okay, let's hurry on back to New York.
Oh.
Yes.
We get off.
We're arriving in New York.
We arrived in New York. We sat on the boat all night, you know, because we come in at night or during the night. In the morning, we get off the boat, and they drive us to the Bronx. There we had a place that was like... two dozen kids of us and all that, you know.
Who drove you over there?
The Hyatts. They were people from the Hyatts. Yeah. And
was there anybody that you could tell them that you had here in the United States?
Yeah, yeah. This is not going to be too, too pleasant that people want to hear. Anyway.
Doesn't matter.
Kids were... remember they had family in America. I knew I had family in America, New York, and all that. So there was a lady there, I forgot her name, and she started looking, okay, I'll look for, I didn't know what a phone book was or nothing, and my uncle, my cousin, my aunts, my two aunts that I have on the picture, they were still living. They were only like 45 minutes away with the subway from me and lived in Brooklyn. Brooklyn and New Jersey.
Did you know at the time that that's where they lived?
No. I knew they were there because we were getting letters. I was a kid. I remember the packages we were getting. We're getting the high-lace shoes for my mother. And you know, I put them on and start walking in them. Okay. She comes back. You have no family here, and nobody. We found some distant relatives in Chicago, but they say you're not the family, and they don't even want to bother with you. I left New York. They want to send us to. They sent us to Cleveland. There was Belfer. There was like a home, Belfer. We were there for about 3-4 months, and then they started...
was this like an orphan home?
Yes, orphan home. We went to school there in Cleveland. I went to school, John Hay High School, and we were there about 3-4 months or so, during 47, from beginning of 47 till the middle of the summer. Went to school there and this and that. Well, you and you going to go to Texas.
Now, who was running that school?
Also the Hyatts and the social workers from Cleveland, from Belfer and all that. Because this was also like a transit, and you going to stay in Cleveland, this and that. I says, I was scheduled to go to Houston, Texas with two more two more guys. I says, I have family somewhere. I don't know, mostly, I think, in New York. I said, how far is Houston from here? He said, oh, about 1,200 miles. 2 days train ride or 3 days train ride. Oh, my God. Pittsburgh. I said, how far is Pittsburgh from New York? Overnight, about 6-7 hours ride. I said, well, I like Pittsburgh because it's closer to New York. Okay, so I came to Pittsburgh with about half a dozen other.
That was one of the choices.
Yeah, I took the choice, and the others went to Houston. Some went to Baltimore, and some stayed in Cleveland. But they wouldn't let me stay in Cleveland. Okay, I came to Pittsburgh and all that. And
Where did you stay in Pittsburgh?
In foster homes. Stayed in one foster home, the first one with Mrs. Hoffman. They lived on Whiteman Street. Stayed there with them, and she had about three, four foster children, you know. Simon Feldman.
How long did you stay with Mrs. Hoffman?
I stood there about 6 months or so.
And what did you do about, I think you were still, what did you do about schooling?
I went to school there from, went to school there first, Fifth Avenue, then I went to Roller Dyes. And then I got a job, part-time job, and after the part-time job, May Stern's company, I didn't go back to full-time school. I went back to night school and looked for a full-time job and got another job. I worked several months on Fifth Avenue, and from there, all my friends and people I know started getting jobs with that machine shop, Bloom's factory in Oakland, and I went.
How did you make your friends? I mean, where did you meet the friends that you made in Pittsburgh?
Well, they were coming over right after me. So we had that friend. I already belonged to that friendship club.
Tell me about the friendship club.
When I came, the friendship club was in motion. That time was the people that came before me and shortly before the war. And it was a wonderful place, a gathering, and made us feel like home. We could talk in our language, in English and German, and we felt like home, and the people were so good and sympathetic and generous to us. We had games and dancing and all kinds of activities. And we met lots of people through them, and through them we met people that were given jobs.
And who were the people who ran the Friendship Club?
Mr. Nachman. You remember?
No, but
he
was
died.
You mean he privately supported this group?
No, it wasn't. They, amongst themselves, they were mostly German. German Jews, and they supported themselves amongst themselves, you know. They had their own club, they had their own synagogue between the Tree of Life and Rod of Shalom, between the Tree of Life, Rod of Shalom, yeah.
And were they the ones who sponsored these activities?
Yeah, they were the ones that sponsored these activities. And as we were coming in, before we know, there was like 25, 30 of us here. A year later, there was double or so, you know, already. Couples came in, and no more young, because we were the only young ones and all that. And we really looked forward every Saturday night together, played ping pong and music, dances, like I said, and we met all kinds of people that they were already established, you know. And we started going down to Bloom, to that machine shop, and he hired a good many of us. When I went down and I started to work there in 1948, there were eight people there. It was me and Al Lewin. You remember Al Lewin?
I don't know these people, so.
Okay. Me, this one. One of them lives in Cleveland. One of them lives there. A couple of them died. So we had a home away from home. Could talk our language and, you know, and this and that.
How long did you work at?
10 years. 10 years. I could have worked longer, finished up my career to work there, but I had a little difficulty, you know, with my marriage and so on.
When were you first married?
I was first married in 1954.
Right here in Pittsburgh?
Right here in Pittsburgh.
And how long was?
3.5 years. That's where I have a son with. Okay, so.
And it was during that time that you worked in Bloom?
Bloom's, mm-hmm. Yeah. So I left there because I had difficulties and it was interfering with my work and all this and that. For 7 years, I just, I remember standing in front of was Weinstein's restaurant. And that time they were doing away with the streetcars. And they took all the tracks out and I was standing outside and watching them work, doing nothing. And my present wife, Ethel, she used to work downtown, and then I get carried away. She used to work downtown, and after a while, I got a job downtown too, working and you know, just a laborer, whatever. And on the way home on the bus, I used to meet her. She used to come home on the bus the same time and all that. And one time, it was a weekend or something, I was standing in front of Weinstein's, and she walked by and this and that and started talking to me, and this, it was Yom Kippur, day of past Yom Kippur. I says, can I walk you home? She lived on Hobart Street, so I walked her home. It wasn't too far. And she invited me into the house, and her mother gave me a piece of honey cake and coffee. I was real, I was real thrilled, you know. It was, it meant more than just the, you know, and it, things started blooming from there. I says, can I take you out? Go on, I said, yeah, sure.
We'll continue this on the next tape. This is tape 6, and Mr. Mangurten, we are now in Pittsburgh. You are in Pittsburgh. You have been divorced, and what happens after you meet your present wife?
Before I met my present wife, I didn't do nothing for a couple of years or so, And I asked her if she would go out with me, and she said yes. And we went out. I didn't have no car then. It was a cold winter night. We walked down. It was about a block to walk down to Phillips and Murray, wait for a bus. And I was really pleased that I was so thrilled. I said, how could a girl commit herself walking down in a cold night waiting for a bus? But she did, and I respected her very much. And this was going on for for a year, but I made an effort. I bought a car, you know, an old used car. I made an effort that we have a car and wouldn't wait for a bus no more. And I went to work. I worked, got a steady job. I worked for a guy on Penn Avenue, Perlman, winding armatures for cars. I never knew what that was, but I did it. I did it. I was there for a year and a half, and anywhere I was away from that Blooms for like 6 years already, you know. So I went down to my union hall, and the people that still worked there remembered me from before and all that, and I says, Mary, I just got married again, you know. I have a couple of kids then already.
Oh, by that time.
Yeah, I need a job, not a gas station job. I need to get back to my, so she says, okay, Hank, used to call me Hank. Okay, here's a slip, go down 39th Street, down Lawrenceville. Plate name of the place was PIE, Pittsburgh Industrial Engineering, a fabricating shop. And the guy, the foreman and all this and that, and what'd you do, where'd you work? I told him I worked, I operated drill presses, I operated a milling machine, I was doing a little welding, like jack of all trades. Okay, show up tomorrow, 7 o'clock. And I started working there, and I already went from $40 a week to $250 an hour. That was $100 a week. Good. You know, and so on. I worked there until, unfortunately, after 3 years, the guy sold out and Levinson bought them out. And started working for, it was Levinson Steel. And from moved to McKee's Rocks. McKee's Rocks, that was already a big haul, you know, but it wasn't so bad. From there, two years later, they got a place in Ambridge, you know, and a big place, fabricating and all that, and we moved to Ambridge, so that was a big sled. That was 25 miles one way, but in the wintertime, it was rough, but I always got up early and took my time and went. And from there, we were fabricating the old airport, not this one, but the old airport. We did a lot of work, the railings and the doors and everything from Blooms. Then with Levinson, we started working, fabricating the beams and foundations for the World Trade Center building, which it wasn't only us, there was maybe 25 other places, but we had a piece of it. And the John Hancock building, a piece of that. The Washington subway, I was learning different new inventions of welding the pipes and tubes and all that. Washington subway, that was most of it. And what else? The Sears building. Well, there was maybe 25 people that was from all over, because one fabricator couldn't keep up with it. But everybody, and I had a piece of this and a piece of that, and so I felt real good. I felt real worthy, you know. And
can I go back now to when you first got married?
Yeah.
What was your wedding like?
Frank, we got married at Rudolf Shalom Temple. Rabbi Jacob married us because an Orthodox rabbi, wouldn't marry us.
Why?
Because I didn't have a Jewish get. She wouldn't give me a Jewish get or whatever, you know. So I says, well,
okay,
we can live with that, you know.
Did you have friends invited to your wedding?
Well, mostly family from out of town, cousins and uncles and this and that.
Had you already made contact with your own family?
Didn't get, I didn't get to that. Oh, my God.
Okay.
In 1949, this friend that I befriended from Iowa, he was looking for me for 4 years. I was already in the States. Finally, he traced me down. In 1950, 51, he traced me down, and him and his wife came to Pittsburgh. He says, you little so-and-so, you know, he didn't swear, but I've been looking for you for 4 years. Traced me down. It was before Pesach. So he was here. He spent about 3 days, went to the Federation, negotiated with them. He had to put collateral money, you know, like a bond and all that. He says, I want to take him with me for spend a week at the farm there, you know, with his family. So I went by train and went to Chicago. Chicago, I had a layoff. Layoff till 3:30 in the afternoon. I was all day. So me, right away, I go look for big department stores, big buildings and all that. I go into this building. I didn't realize what it was, with Marshall Field department stores. And I look and I see, I spoke a little English already. I couldn't get lost. And I saw telephone books. I open up a telephone book, and there's a half a dozen Mangurtens in the book. Melvin and Jack and Henry and this and that and this and that. And they're the ones that she told me that they're not even related to me. They don't want to see me. So they says, you know, we wanted to go and to New York to meet you and all that, and they wouldn't let us for some reason or another. I don't want to talk about it. Because they had to maintain numbers. It was a numbers game. So I went to, so they met me at the train station, this and that. We didn't have much time already. I said, you know what? On the way back from Iowa, I'll spend a week here with the whole family. And they were all my dad's first cousins and so forth and so on. So this Melvin says to me, you know, Henry, I was in New York and I looked in the book and I saw Meilich Max Mangurten and High Herman Mangurten. His name was Herman, but he went under the name High and all that. And he got the address and all that. And he says, well, here it is. When you go back to Pittsburgh, give him a call. This was 1951 already. Give him a call and see who they are. I come back to Pittsburgh. I had this guy call, you know, I wrote him a card and all that, told him who I was. And they call me back. My youngest brother's son. We've been looking for you. So I, first thing I said, have you heard from my parents, my father, mother? Nobody. No Gucci or nobody. So I knew that whoever said that knew my father made a mistake. Because if he lived, he would have contacted them. That time already I missed the two aunts, and my uncle's wife passed away and so on. But he was still living, and his son and his two daughters.
So he was an elder brother to your father.
He was my dad's oldest brother. And he says, I've been looking for you. My youngest dad's brother and all this and that. And that was the beginning of the relations.
Okay, now we are at your second marriage, and after that, do you have children?
Yes,
second marriage.
Tell me
about them.
We had, I have pictures of them. We had two girls and a boy.
And tell me their names. Who was born first?
Sheila was born first. Janice was born second. Ken was born last, third.
And now, where are they today?
Ken is in Pittsburgh. He's married. He has two children, a boy and a girl.
What are their names?
Their name is Julie and Jack. Mm-hmm. Julie is 6 years old, and Jack is 3 years old. And Sheila lived in Israel for 3-4 years, and she went to school there and worked as a social worker too, and all that. Come back, and she met this fella from New York. He was going to school here, and he was a resident, worked for the coroner's office. And so when they met at the young Israeli or whatever, they met, and a relationship developed, and you better have some money. We're getting they got married. We had a lovely wedding at the Polizetic, a real Orthodox wedding, which it wasn't up to me, but my daughter.
Your daughter and her.
And her husband there, New York. And it was beautiful. Had people from everywhere coming in. It was a real Orthodox wedding. So they got married, and after a few weeks, they go to Israel. They go to Israel, and her first two boys were born in Israel.
What are their names?
David and Avi. David is 10, Avi is 8, and then Joey was born here.
Where did they go to live when they came from Israel?
He couldn't get a job here, and he was willing to stay in Pittsburgh, but he couldn't get getting a job. So he went back to New York. They went to New York. They lived with their mother. His father died before that. And they lived there with them for about a year or so, and he got a job in Brooklyn Hospital. And after 6 months or so, they got their own place. They moved out, got their own place, and God bless them, they're doing real good. And the boys were having lots of fun with them. Can't wait to see them.
And you get to see them
once a year. Mm-hmm. And
Now Janice
got married. Also got married. She met a fellow in Charleston, South Carolina. Her and two girlfriends went down. She was a St. Francis graduate, registered nurse and all that. So they went down to Charleston, South Carolina. They got jobs there. And there was a big Air Force base and the Naval base. And I guess they were going out, in the evening or so, and she met this guy. He was a lieutenant or a captain in the Air Force, pilot. And uniform, tall uniform, and a captain and a pilot and all that. They started before Mom, Dad, we're getting married. We're getting married. So we went to South Carolina, Charleston, took all the stuff down, baked and this and that. And he wasn't Jewish, though. It was a mixed. So between some of his family, his grandmother, and a lot of them, I couldn't blame him for opposing, because he was a real religious boy too, And all of a sudden, what are you doing with the Jewish girl, But anyway, he did what he did, So they went to Germany. After he was assigned to Germany, he was flying out of Germany. They lived in Germany for 3 years. And their first son, Zach, was born there in Germany. And they had good times. And, she went all over and she said, Dad, is it okay if I go there, like near camps and this and that? I said, go ahead. Don't let me stop you, and don't think of anything. Just go ahead and,
Learn.
Experience, learn, and that's it. And then they came back. They stayed with us for about 6 months or so, you know. And where did they go from there? They went to Dallas, Texas, Chicago. So all of a sudden, we're back in Chicago. They lived there for about 6 months. He was stationed there, and from there, he was sent to Dallas, Texas. And that's where they went and lived. And after 4 years of marriage or so, things started going because, like I say, his sisters and brothers and part of the family and this started giving him a hard time, you know, and this and that. Well, okay. She took it hard, you know, but eventually they divorced.
And where is she living now?
She's still living in Dallas. She's working at the Children's Hospital, but they had another little boy, Aaron. He's 4 years old now. He's 5 years old. They had another little boy, and they live in Texas. She works in a Children's Hospital there. And
had you always told your children about your experience in the Holocaust? Did you speak about that during their lives?
My oldest daughter, she's into it. She's the one that brought me some stuff from Yad Vashem, names and all that. My other two, they're different types, you know. Well, I feel sorry, but Dad, what can I do? What do you want me to do? You know, that happened so long ago. I says, I'm not asking you for sympathy. I'm not looking for anything from you. God bless you. Go about your business, and you know. And so they were less involved. But my other one in New York, she was really involved.
But what you're saying, though, is that you did speak to them about it all along. They knew about this background.
I used to get together with friends and all that, and they understood. We would talked about it and all that. Oh, they knew everything. They heard about it, and we talked from time to time, little by little. But I wasn't too explicit, too tragic about it, because I didn't want to get them. If they had the feeling for it and they really wanted it, okay. But since they were a little light on the subject, I avoided it as much as I could, except with the older one.
How do you think that your experiences in the Holocaust affected the raising of your children? Do you think it had an effect on the way you raised your children?
When my first son was born from the first wife, I couldn't sleep. I was worried, nervous. Because I looked at the baby and what I saw, what was done. I dreamt. When I lived with foster people here, not that I blame them, I was only young. It was only, not even that, yeah, it was not even 2 years after the war. I had nightmares. He's coming after me. I'm being shot, chased me and all that. Scream, woke up in a sweat and all that. I didn't blame people, but the next day, are you crazy or something? What were you screaming and making all kinds of noise? What were you doing there? You know. I didn't say nothing. Because if people didn't have enough common sense, then what's the use of me telling them? Then when I got married and we had one, second, and third, I had difficulty sleeping, difficulty being away from them. What's going to happen to them? Who's going to get them? Where are they going to go and what they're going to do with them? This was going on for years and years and years. They even couldn't. I didn't want to show them that I was protective of them, because I saw results from other people, you know, God forbid, some kids ended up in institutions. In fact, I know there's maybe two or three of them that are in institution. They're in their 40s now. I just let them go. They had friends. They went to Hillel. They had friends. They had enough activities to keep them busy and so on. And they didn't look like they were frightened. They always showed that they didn't need no protection and all this. So I didn't push. I just let it take its course, you know, because my parents, like, were protective of me. I didn't have no brothers or sisters, you know. I used to get mad because I had to go in the apartment before the other kids were called in. But I went, you know. So those kids were, I couldn't, my mind and always was going back 4 or 5 years, 10 years. I don't even want to talk about what I saw and this and that. It's little kids throwing on trucks like sack of potatoes. That picture, Escape from Sobibor, I don't know who the maker, producer, but they interviewed these guys and just like a clone, like it's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. I don't understand. I cannot comprehend unless this was filmed right then and there.
You mean the way they described it?
The way the action was going, you know, just filming it right along with the action. Yeah. They showed it already 4 or 5 times, and I haven't missed it. Well, the reason, it gives me a sense of feeling I am home with my people and we're all in the same boat, you know.
And what would you say now that you're here at this time and this videotape is being made, what would you want to say to the people who see it?
To the people who see children,
but what are your thoughts about this experience you had in your life?
I like to say to the people, God bless you. Hope you never experience what I did. Because this was not only inhumane, unbelievable, incomprehensible, unimaginable, indescribable. To look back took take my mother, my dad, take young people, gas them, burn them. Why? For what? I was naive enough to do things that I should not have done. And I shouldn't be here. But when I think that a guy like Mengele had a big part in saving my life, because there would have been no return from there. Would have been no return from there. And my mother, maybe she survived. Maybe they took the baby from my aunt because they were a young woman, you know, and sent him to work. But you know, sometimes our women didn't want to give up the baby, this or that. My mother wanted to go with her. It was her younger sister. So I have no way of knowing whether she went immediately or later. Though, then, when I came to Pittsburgh, I was here already 4 or 5 years. There was a lady named Yetta Middleman was her name. She used to work in the Federation. She was my social worker and all that. And I told her what happened, that I heard my dad was here and there. And she started writing letters and all that. And all of a sudden, she calls me up. She gives me a letter. I don't know what happened to it. My dad's birthday, day and date and year that he was perished in either Gross Rosen or Theresienstadt, where I was going to be sent. And he died like a month before the liberation, in April sometime. It was so real, I couldn't believe it, because I never told him how old my father was or what year he was born. I told him he was in his middle 40s or so, you know. But she come back with all that, so they must have found those names and documents and all that, just like they Yad Vashem had.
Well, Mr. Van Gordon, thank you for sharing this story.
Thank you. I got quite a load off my chest.
Okay. What is this picture, Mr. Van Gordon?
Top left is my father. And next to him on the left is supposedly my mother. I'm not sure. The bottom two ladies are my father's sisters, aunts, Esther and Hannah. But I'm not sure who is who. And next to her with the flowers must be her husband, Jacob Eisen. And the rest our nieces and nephews.
Okay, where was the picture taken?
In Lodz.
Mm-hmm. And when?
1921, this picture was taken, mm-hmm. before they scattered and moved out to Scandinavia and England.
And how did you get the picture? From whom did you get the picture?
From my uncle in New York when I first met him in 1951. He showed.
Okay, where was this picture taken?
This picture was taken in Lodz.
In what year?
1916.
And who's
my dad and his younger sisters, teenagers. This picture was taken in 1945. In Bindermichel, Linz, Austria, DP camp. And this was a wedding, the first wedding after the war. And I don't remember all the people there, but...
Where are you in the picture?
I am the second from the right on the bottom.
This is tape 7 and a continuation of Mr. Mangurten's pictures. Go ahead.
This picture was also taken at Bindermichel, across the street, across the road. It was woods, and this was in the summertime. People wanted to get sunburns, and I was in my...
What year was this?
1945, in the summertime. Okay. And I worked with the military in the kitchen, and I had my KP uniform on. This picture was taken in 1984 at my sister-in-law and brother-in-law's house. My another sister-in-law got married.
And where was this?
This was in North Hills, McCandless Township. This picture was taken there. From left is Janice, me, my wife Ethel, Sheila, and Kenny, my son. These are the children of my eldest daughter, Sheila. They were taken in New York City at their home. David from the left, Avi in the center, and Joey from the right. Three gangsters.
What year?
1996. This picture was taken in 1994 in Dallas, Texas. Aaron is 5 years old.
Is he 5 years old in this picture?
Yeah.
No, it was taken in 1994.
He was taken, he was a year and a half or so.
I believe that he...
94?
94, 2 years ago. He would be three.
Yeah, he was 3 years old. Mm-hmm. So. This is my other daughter, Janice. Her firstborn boy, his name is Zach. He is 8 years old now. This was taken, he was three and a half years old when this was taken. These are the children of my son, Ken, and Amy Mangurten. Julie is 4 years old. And Jack is a little over a year old.